Good morning and welcome to worship here at Christ Church United Methodist. My name is Jacob and it is my joy, my privilege, my honor, and my delight to welcome you into this space this morning. God has been good to us here, as evidenced in everything that we have seen, everything that we have experienced, and everything that we are doing here at Christ Church United Methodist. So if you are not connected to this ministry and you want to find out more, I invite you to look to our e-news and our website. If you don't know what the e-news is and aren't currently getting this weekly update, I invite you to drop your name and your email address in the comment section right now, and one of our devoted staff or volunteers will make sure to get you added into that list. God indeed has been good. And because God has been good, we respond with our worship. So I invite you now to center your hearts, your minds, as we come in together to worship our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer. The Lord indeed truly is in this holy place. Let all of us fall silent before our God. Let's worship God together. Thank you, Ben, for that wonderful rendition of Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. Friends, I invite you now to join with me in our call to worship that is printed on your screen. As darkness gives way to light and winter sleep to fresh beginnings,
we come today to be reminded of God's love for us.
Like the green shoots of renewed life stirring beneath the soil,
we welcome an awakening of God's word in our lives.
In this time of reflection and repentance,
we affirm our identity, we claim our security as children of God.
Please join with me in singing wherever you are with an uplifted voice, our opening hymn, Sing Praise to God Who Reigns Above. I invite you now to join with me in our affirmation of faith. Christ Church, wherever you are, I have a question for you this morning. What do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Hear now from my friend and yours, Leanne Hadley, as she gives us a time for children and all of us who are young at heart. Leanne, take it away.
Good morning. My name is Leanne, and it is time for the children's time. So children, would you please come close to your screens? And do you know what this is? This is a chrysalis. This used to be a caterpillar, but the caterpillar transformed into a chrysalis. And soon, you know what will happen, that caterpillar will become a butterfly. This is Lent. It is the first Sunday of Lent, and Lent lasts 6 Sundays. And it's a time where we sort of get into a little chrysalis, a spiritual chrysalis, and think, what is it that God wants me to do next in my spiritual journey? How is God going to change me in these next 6 weeks? So, and I don't know about you, but for me, COVID has been a year long of being in a chrysalis. I feel like we're on the verge of emerging. So for these next 6 weeks, what I would like to do is invite you to pray with me and just spend some time in prayer and pondering, what is it that God is calling us to do next? How has God used COVID and using these next 3 weeks to transform us into the people God has called us to be? So, our scripture lesson this morning is about Jesus. He goes into a temple and he gets very angry because they're doing wrong things in the temple. And he's very bold and he's very brave. So this morning, I want to do a bold and brave prayer. So, here's what we're going to do. You'll have to keep your eyes open because this prayer has motions. So, would you pray with me and keep your eyes open? First of all, I want you to make a little chrysalis. And put that chrysalis right on your heart. And I want you to be very still. I wonder today how God is calling us to be bold and brave. What have we learned about ourselves in this past year? What are we learning now? In what areas of our life does God call us to be brave and bold? Let's think about that. Oh God, you call us to be brave and you call us to be bold. We are not always strong, but you are. So help us to be the brave and the bold people you call us to be. Amen. Jesus was bold and he was brave. And God is calling us in lots of areas in our lives to be bold and to be brave. I wonder, what is God doing? What is God calling you to do next in your spiritual journey? I'll see you next week.
Shelter of the Lord, who abided his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and God will raise you up.
As we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, I invite your attention to our Paschal candle, which is lit this morning in celebration of Annabelle Louise Logan, who was baptized during our in-person worship experience on February 14th. We give God thanks for her and for her mother, Nicole, who also joined Christ Church during that service. We also would like to celebrate Mark and Deb Gorin, who joined Christ Church on February 14th. It is indeed exciting to see all that God is doing in this season. So welcome to Nicole, Mark, and Deb. We look forward to continuing this journey of growing in grace and becoming living proof of God's love, one person at a time. It's prayer time in the household of faith. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for all of your good and gracious gift, for the portion of bounty that we see and experience every day, for our lives and for our health, for food on our tables and clothes on our backs, for the roofs over our head, for the shoes on our feet. God, if we had 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough to thank you. So help us, Lord, to be mindful of every drop that you have showered upon us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sovereign God, we pray for the leaders and authorities that govern the nations of the world. Grant them a special portion of your wisdom, that they might lead with integrity and in truth. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of your justice and your shalom. Amid the divisiveness, may we be united as your children, celebrating both our uniqueness and diversity, so that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for those who are battling illness of any kind. Touch them, O Lord, with your healing hand. For those in this season who don't have a roof over their head, for those who, for many reasons, might find themselves without electrical power, for all those whom everything just seems to be too much, specifically for our brothers and sisters in Texas, Kyrie eleison. God, strengthen us that we may be ever mindful as we seek to be your hands and feet here in the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, as we journey in this Lenten season, surprise us, Lord. Shine down your light of truth so that we might have the wisdom and insight to discern your will for our lives. And in this discernment, may the unctioning of the Holy Ghost give us courage to do your will, that we might be all that you're calling us to be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now we join the chorus of the saints throughout the ages, praying the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This morning's scripture reading is from Mark chapter 11, verses 15 through 18. Listen for the word of God.
Jesus cleanses the temple. Then they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and saying,
"Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations'? But you have made it a den of robbers."
And when the chief priests and the scribes heard it, they kept looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was spellbound by his teaching.
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, hello, Christ Church. It is wonderful to be with you in worship today. And thank you so much, Ken and Cindy, for that wonderful reading of the gospel lesson today. It's great to be back in the sanctuary after recording last week's sermon from my home because of weather. As we begin today, let us, as always, join our hearts in prayer. Well, gracious and loving God, we again thank you for this moment, this time of worship where we can come together in this way. We thank you, Lord, that you join us in this moment. And Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts would be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. And all God's people at home said, Amen. Well, Kathy and I, early on in our marriage and ministry years, were very blessed to live in a number of parsonages. And a parsonage, in case you don't know, it's a home that's owned by the church that the pastor lives in with his or her family. And again, we were blessed to live in a few of those in those early years of ministry. And the thing about a parsonage is that they're often right there on church property, so you don't have a long drive to church or very close to the church. And that also means that you get visitors from time to time. People would stop by often with gifts of food or other expressions of love, or sometimes they just wanted to come by and visit, and sometimes we would know they were coming, and sometimes we just wouldn't. And we made all of that work, and we're grateful and blessed. But here's the thing about that. That was a time in our life when we were both working very full-time, and I was going to seminary, and the children were little and beginning to get into all of their activities, and I have to make a little bit of a confession here, and maybe some of you with families with school-aged children struggle with this too, but sometimes the house would get pretty cluttered, and we weren't really sure if it was okay to receive visitors. But we had a solution for this, Kathy and I did. We had a time, of course, every week where we would pick up the house, but in between those times, if somebody would make a visit that was unannounced, we kind of knew what to do. I called it our hurry-up offense. And here's what would happen. As soon as we heard the crunch of the tires on the driveway there at the parsonage, I would look at Kathy, and Kathy would look at me, and we would spring into action. And I tell you what, Tom Brady and Gronkowski were not more efficient in their offense, as Kathy and I were, of getting things decluttered really quickly. She would grab this, I would grab that. We'd already schooled the children, grab anything out here that you own and run for your bedroom, and don't come out until you comb your hair and wash your face, and please put some pants on. All of that would take place in a matter of just a few seconds until Kathy or I could open the door and say, "Well, what a pleasant surprise. Would you like to come in?" I mention that because I suspect that all of us from time to time have maybe struggled with that, with clutter in our homes. And I have to tell you that now that the kids are grown and have moved out, well, our house is a lot less cluttered and a lot less busy in many ways. It's also a lot more quiet. Today we are beginning a new message series called The Week That Changed the World. And we're going to be looking through this Lenten series. We're going to be looking at the last week of Jesus' life and some of the significant events that happened during that time. And we're going to be considering how that event changed the world, but also changes us, changes our lives. And when we look at the passage today, and the title of the sermon today is Clean House. That's what Jesus is doing. He's cleansing the temple. I shared that story of the hurry-up offense that Kathy and I had because, well, it's Lent, and just a few nights ago, we gathered either online here or here in the sanctuary for an Ash Wednesday service. And we were reminded of our mortality. We were invited to observe a season of Lent. We heard the words, or something like them, "From the dust you have come, and to the dirt you shall return." That's a sobering message. It's an invitation to enter into a season of spiritual preparation for Easter, which will come on April 4th this year. It's a time of self-examination, of self-denial, a time of bringing in perhaps more robust spiritual disciplines into our lives. It's a time to clean house, emotionally, spiritually, if you will. And that really does bring us to the gospel lesson today. Let me just set the context just a little bit as we begin, because we find Jesus in this chapter of Mark riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, on a colt. It's called the Triumphant Entry, remembered by history as such, and we'll be talking about that on Palm Sunday in a few weeks. But Jesus comes into town as a Messiah was expected to do so. The way he came into town, on the back of that colt, people waving their branches and putting their clothing down in front of him and shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest." There were great shouts of affirmation as he was coming into town that day. But the tone and the mood, it was about to change. Earlier in the chapter, we were told that Jesus had walked into Jerusalem and then walked into the temple, and he looked around at everything. He saw everything in the temple. More about that in a few minutes. But given the events that were about to take place in the coming days, I expect that Jesus was sizing things up a little bit just to see what he would be up against. Then he went to a place of peace, Bethany, for the evening to rest up and to prepare for what was ahead. Then he returns to the temple the next day, and the outer courts of it contained people selling doves for sacrifice and exchanging currency so people could pay their temple tax. And we're told that he turned over tables. He drove them out, to those money changers and those selling the doves, with a whip of cords, and he wouldn't allow anyone to do anything. We see Jesus, well, he's about to clean house here, so to speak. In our message today, I want to invite all of us to a house cleaning party, if you will, with Jesus, as we ask three important questions. And the first question is this: why was Jesus angry? Why was Jesus angry? Because make no mistake, Jesus is, he's angry here. He's angry. And let's just talk about anger for a moment. Anger in and of itself is not a bad thing. I guess it really just depends on where the anger is coming from and what we do with that anger. The Apostle Paul addresses this subject in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, where he admonishes, "In your anger, do not sin, and do not let the sun go down on your anger." Sounds like good advice to me. It's what you do with your anger. Don't sin in your anger. Settle that anger. Reconcile with a person before the day is done. But he doesn't say, don't ever be angry. And remember Jonah's anger on the hillside a few weeks ago in the Jonah series. He's overlooking Nineveh. And the Lord asked Jonah a couple of times, is it right for you to be angry? You know, Jonah's anger, it was born from his hatred and his racism toward the people of Nineveh, and because of God's gracious outreach and response toward them. Yet God seemed to allow Jonah just to seethe and to simmer in his anger on that hillside. And as you remember, we were just kind of left hanging at the end of that story to wonder what happened with Jonah. How did he ever get home? But what about Jesus? I mean, he wrecked what was going on, that mess that was going on in the temple that day. Why did he do that? Well, verse 11, again, we were told that Jesus, upon entering Jerusalem, entered the temple and looked around at everything. What did he see? Well, the temple in Jesus' day was a marvel of the ancient world. It was built in such a way that it was the dominant structure in Jerusalem. And it had concentric courtyards, if you will, or areas that were considered even more sacred or more holy or more exclusive as you entered finally to the Holy of Holies, the most holy place that was considered the seat of God or the place where God's presence was represented on the earth. but in that outermost courtyard. It was called the Court of the Gentiles. And that was a place where everyone could gather for prayer. Everyone could gather for prayer. And what was happening during that time, of course, it was Passover week. So pilgrims were coming in from all over the known world, faithful Jews, coming to worship, to pray, to sacrifice, and to pay their temple tax. And in that outer court, that court of the Gentiles, it doesn't sound like there was a lot of prayer going on in that house of prayer, but there was a lot of selling, there was a lot of trading, and there was a lot of busyness and exploitation going on. Because what would happen as people were buying doves for a sacrifice is that they were being exploited with an exorbitant upcharge. And by the way, when you paid your temple tax, well, when you paid that, you couldn't pay with the coin of the realm. You couldn't pay with Roman coinage or Phoenician coinage or Greek coinage. It was considered unclean. So it was kind of like what happened when we used to get off an airplane in a country overseas and you had to exchange your money. And if you've ever done that, I've always wondered, is that right? am I getting a little ripped off? I guess it's okay. And people were getting ripped off in that. And then they got ripped off again if their temple tax, if they paid that and needed change coming back, there was a charge for that as well. And Jesus saw all of this going on, and he was righteously angered. And he did something about it that day. He kicked over their tables. In another gospel account, we're told he made a whip of cords and he drove them out of the temple, drove them out of the court of the Gentiles. You know, when you think about it, anger can be petty and destructive and even self-defeating. We can imagine Jonah on that hillside. Or it can be righteous and it can be restorative. And if we want a clean house with Jesus this Lenten season, you know, when we see something that's not right, we need to find a way to be a healing presence, especially if there's anger in the midst of that. Years ago, when I was pastor of a church in the urban center of a city, we had a church that thankfully, it looked like our neighborhood. We had all of God's children in that church, people of different backgrounds and different socioeconomic statuses and different skin colors, and it was quite an adventure to be the pastor of a church like that in that kind of a setting. And I remember one evening a group of members of the church came to me. We had a commodities giveaway because there were so many poor people in the neighborhood, they just needed things. And they said, "Hey, Pastor," they were really upset. They felt they were being discriminated against by the person who was running that ministry, that they weren't receiving anything that was really being offered by the church. And it was all happening. The giveaway was happening right there in the middle of worship and the dinner we did on Sunday evening. And it was all in the open. And honestly, I was a little bit skeptical, but I promised. I said, "Well, I'm going to keep an eye. I'm going to pay attention. And if something like that's happening, I promise you, we'll fix it." And I didn't have to watch very long. And I saw what was happening. And I said something to the person leading that ministry and confronted that, and we straightened it out. But I was really humbled that day, and I realized that I need to pay attention. It was happening right in front of my eyes, right under my nose, and I hadn't seen it. That was a moment of quite frankly, confrontation and a little bit of upset and anger, but it also led to restoration and some justice in that situation. Friends, pay attention. Be ready to be that bridge, that healing presence in the world that it so desperately needs right now. As we open our eyes and pay attention, we can do this on our own and figure out ways to heal our divides. And we can also join our church in ministries that attempt to do that. Just reach out to us or reach out to Reverend Patty Grote, our Plant Faith and Outreach and Justice pastor, and she'd be glad to connect you with some of those kinds of ministries. The second question is this: why were the religious leaders frightened? Why were they frightened? Well, by turning over those tables, by not letting anybody carry out or do anything in the temple for a little while anyway, that would have hit them economically. It also challenged their authority. And it must have shaken them to the core just a little bit. Mostly, though, we're told by Mark that they were frightened because the people were spellbound by Jesus. And we know this from other accounts in the gospel, that people recognized Jesus. They were spellbound by him because they recognized the truth of what he was preaching and teaching. They recognized his genuineness. They felt his authority. We're told in other parts of the gospel that he taught with authority, unlike the elders and the chief priests. He was the real deal, as they say, and people knew it. And think of the people who were coming to the temple to worship, to pray, to pay their temple tax, to experience God, to worship. Those folks were being exploited by those practices in the temple or the courtyard of the Gentiles. They were being exploited by that system, if you will, and how they would have felt by the actions that Jesus took that day. I imagine it would have been a sign of great hope and great encouragement for folks who had traveled so far on such meager means, only to be exploited even more once they got to the temple, to God's house. So I guess if we want to clean house with Jesus this Lenten season, we need to understand and believe that Jesus comes to us too, in the midst of our fears and in the midst of the tender places in life. And just as he joined the poor and the powerless in our gospel lesson today, well, he joins us too as we feel so powerless against all the chaos and weirdness, if you will, of this present age. I mean, how can we not be fearful these days? As we watch news or attend to social media, one of the ways I'm not as fearful is to limit my exposure to both of those two things in particular. When you think about it, fear can drive us to terrible places as individuals and as a society. But as people of faith, as we experience fear, let us take our deepest fears and insecurities to Jesus, especially during this season of Lent, and allow the balm of his mercy and grace to heal our sore and sick, wearied hearts. This is a week, friends, that changed the world as we look at the last week of Jesus' life, because this action by Jesus of cleansing the temple put him in the religious leaders' crosshairs for good. I mean, this was it. They were going to have him killed. They were going to get rid of him. He was going to die on a cross by the end of the week. All those shouts of Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, those shouts were going to be very different come Friday. They were going to be shouts of crucify him, crucify him. It was a week that changed the world, but it was also a week that changes us as we ask the third question, and it's this: what tables need to be turned over in your life, in my life? This is a rather personal question that we can take to the Lord this Lent. And I'm not even sure how to answer that question in my own life at this moment. But I do think it has something to do with my own desire to have not only events around me, but God even, fit into my expectations and my hopes and dreams. Not the all of my or your hopes or expectations are wrong or bad. They're just not necessarily God's. Remember, God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. Perhaps what needs to be turned over in my life and maybe even yours is our resistance to simply hear and yield to the word and will of God. I know that's a big statement because the word of God, the Bible, is a big book. But I think as we consider the whole witness of Scripture, we can see it yielding to that Scripture, particularly around themes of mercy and justice and salvation and hope and love. Well, as we yield ourselves to the word and will of God, well, that's allowing God and Jesus to kick over some tables in my life. They certainly will be. As we open up our lives this Lent more fully to God, as we enhance and deepen our spiritual disciplines and practices, we can count on God coming into our life and continuing that process of sanctification in our heart, of making us more into the people that God would have us be in Christ Jesus' love. So friends, let us continue to open our hearts and to yield to what Jesus might drive from us. So I'd like to conclude the message today by the lyrics from a song, Clean This House, by gospel artist Isaac Currie. In the words, some of them go like this. Oh yeah, Lord, I thank you for forgiving me over and over again, yeah. I'm calling on you, Heavenly Father, I'm down on my knees. You said call on you no matter the hour, Lord, I'm in need. I've been messing up, done lost my house, done lost my job, wife walking out. These church folks say they my friends, but I'm all they talk about. I've been doing wrong, I'm so sorry, Lord, please forgive me. We confess to him, he'll remove all wickedness. The blood from your son will wash me from my sins. Clean this house from the inside out. Restore me, take away my impurity. Lord, I need you to clean this house from the inside out. Restore me, take away my impurity. And let it be so. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Eric, for that wonderful, challenging message. I pray that we all might wrestle with the question, what is God calling us to clean in our own houses? And as we ponder that, I invite us to continue in that spirit of worship as we prepare to give back unto God a portion of what God has given to us. Indeed, it is offering time here at Christ Church. There is a link on your screen that informs you of all of the different ways that you can sow into this ministry and partner with us. For just as Jesus cleaned house on that day, we are still cleaning house today, and we are blessed to have the resources to clean house in this community and in our world. So as we give unto God, I pray that you might receive this offering from this dynamic quartet as they render unto our hearing the words of the centuries-old hymn, Be Thou My Vision.
Oh.
Well, friends, when we think about our invitation to discipleship today and cleaning house is not just about removing things that need to be removed. It's also about replacing or adding in things that need to be brought into our spiritual house in this case. I want to invite you this coming week to do something that you don't normally do. Some kind of act of mercy or grace towards somebody else. Maybe write them an encouraging note or do a kindness for a neighbor or a family member. I want to encourage you to be very intentional about reaching out and being a healing and gracious presence for somebody in your life this week. You'll be blessed, and so will they.
Give him all your years of pain, and you'll enter into life in Jesus' name. Jesus, oh Jesus, come and fill.
As always, this has been a wonderful and rich time for us to be together. And as we leave this space and go into the world in so many different ways, I invite you to go forth in the love of God the Father, the grace of His Son, Jesus the Christ. Go forth in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Friends, go forth in peace. Amen.